الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلق الله أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، all praise is due to Allah and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his companions and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the Day of Judgment. Is this sister going to Jannah? The title perhaps stirs up many thoughts and ideas. Why this title? Or why this topic? For a number of reasons. One of which is based on the hadith which was reported to us by both Bukhari and Muslim, on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu wa arda, wherein the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya ma'ashara al-nisa tasaddaqna fa'inni ra'aytukunna akthara ahli al-nar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O women, give charity, because verily I saw that you comprised the majority of the people in the hellfire. Now the sisters may be thinking, why? What did I do? Why will there be more women or more women than men in Jahannam? Well, we will see. Malish, if you can all try to be silent so we will not lose track of what's going on. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum. Continuing. Why would that be the case? And why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam address the women in particular and command them to give sadaqah more than he did to the men, and then warning them that the reason why he was telling them that because they comprised the largest majority of the people in the hellfire? Women in Islam are unlike women outside Islam, and this I will elaborate on in a little bit, inshallah. But the question is, if this is a fact, and it is a fact, right? Does anyone second doubt the Prophet ﷺ? Anyone doubt his speech? Does he speak of his own desires? Does he lie? Does he fabricate information according to his whims? No way. What he said was revelation given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the sister should ask herself, now, this sister here in this auditorium, or sisters who will hear this in the future, am I among those? Am I going to be among those whom he, alayhi sallam, said that they will be the majority of the people of the hellfire? Or are you a sister who is going to Jannah? In case you have thought that this is unimportant, think again. Because there's nothing more important than this. Everything in this dunya and everything in this worldly life is almost virtual. It's almost unreal. The evidence is, most of us don't remember what we did a week ago. And if we did, it will be nothing more than an image or a thought. You remember that you had a calamity or that you had something that pleased you, but it ends with that. Everything just seems to go away. Excuse me. What will remain is the life to come. That is where eternity really is. So when we speak about Jahannam and Jannah, and we had lectures dedicated to these two topics, then we shouldn't take the matter lightly. A sister should not feel that she has guaranteed her 2 feet in Jannah until she evaluates herself according to the standards of Islam. Then and only then, if she finds herself, alhamdulillah, adhering to the teachings, then this is good news for her. And glad tidings that inshallah ta'ala, Allah Azza wa Jal will give her that and more. However, if a sister finds that she has some shortcomings, then the objective of these lectures always and forever is not to depress us or make us feel down or get reprimanded every time we come here. Rather, it is to change our ways, return to Allah, and fix up the situation. That's what it is. Women are no exception. Now, anyone who's involved in da'wah, if you ever give da'wah, you will find that very often you will find much resistance when you deal with these issues, you know, men or women. But in these areas, because we're dealing with women, women seem to have a lot of resistance when we speak about these issues, very often based on their own understanding of things, their own desires, or arguments that are really Islamically baseless. And because of this reality, because of the fact that when we try to remind, we find resistance, we find, okay, this is extreme, but I need to live my life, but this and but that, and you know, you kind of feel that the system makes you feel as if you're handcuffing her and putting her in prison, even though you are liberating her. She's being liberated even though she feels she's being in prison. And I will give you some evidences for that soon, inshaAllah ta'ala. Because of that, we must have some foundation. As in our last lecture, before we tackled the issue of the beard for the men, we said that we must first understand the rights of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before we deal with the issue, which becomes a minor issue in comparison to the major issue, which is La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah told us in the Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu udkhulu fis silmi kaffa wa la tattabi'u khutuwati ash-shaytan innahu lakum aduwwun mubin. This is a very important ayah in the book of Allah. O you who have believed, udkhulu, enter, fis silm. Now, silm and Islam are synonymous, according to Ibn Abbas and Mujahid and many of the Mufassirin and the Sahaba. As-silm here is submission. Enter into Islam wholeheartedly. What does that mean? All the way, completely. Accept everything that Islam had commanded you to do. Don't go 50-50, 75-25, or any other percentages. Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa. This is the command. Then there was a warning. And do not follow the footsteps of the devil, the shaitan. Verily he is to you a clear enemy. Meaning, the reason why we will not enter into Islam wholeheartedly is because we will follow the footsteps of the shaitan. Is the shaitan someone who wishes goodness for you? No. He's your clear enemy. He wants to take you to Jahannam. Now, he's not going to tell you, hey, come on, let's go to Jahannam, because no one will go. Right? If he came and whispered to you, would you like to burn in the fire for some years? No one will say, oh yeah, okay, sure. What do I have to do? Okay, disobey Allah. Alright, that sounds good. No, 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 no. He doesn't do that. He's not stupid. He has tricks. He will beautify ugly stuff. He will make you think you're so intelligent that you are more wise than Allah. This is the biggest calamity. You start thinking, oh, I know, I know. What Allah commanded here is not really suitable, you see. What is good, according to me, according to my mind, is that I do or I behave in this particular fashion. Ajeeb. Can someone believe that he's more wise than Allah? He's wiser than Allah? He knows what is suitable for the children of Adam more than the creator of the children of Adam? It's unbelievable. But believe it or not, this is how the shaitan will get to one of us. So much so that we will abandon clear texts from the Quran and the Sunnah on the grounds that we have a better understanding of the implications of these teachings. So we wind up following the footsteps of the shaitan and going straight to Jahannam. How does one free himself from that? By not using his intellect to reject the Quran and the Sunnah, rather using the intellect to understand the Quran and the Sunnah. That's it. It's a very simple matter to whomever Allah makes it simple. But if we strive, Allah Azza wa Jalla is merciful. If you really want to have understanding of the deen, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala shall not deprive you. Verse number 2. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَن يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. It is not for a believing man or a believing woman. After Allah and His Messenger have decided regarding a matter or affair, that they should have an opinion regarding that matter. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger has went far astray. The third verse, as a foundation for us to understand what I will be delivering soon, inshallah, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مؤمنين عَفْوًا إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا الحمد لله وَأُولَئِكَ هُمْ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Verily, the only statement of the true believers. Now, the fake believers, they have a whole other state, right? The believers who are not really, you know, firm on the deen, they have another statement. But for the real believers, the true believers, their only statement, whenever they are called to be judged by Allah and His Messenger, that they should say, we listen and we obey, and it is those who are successful. Meaning, if we don't have this particular quality, meaning we are missing on elements of success. If you're not successful, you are a loser. You're either successful or you're a loser. If you don't have the qualities of success, we have the qualities of the losers and the people who will be at loss. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. But Allah swore by the passage of time that humans are in loss. Fi. They are submerged in loss. Except those who believe and do righteous deeds until the end of the surah. So then, sisters, this is an intro. So you will know that what is about to be presented to you is not optional. Keeping in mind that the methodology which I follow in these lectures, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His grace, that if there's a difference of opinion regarding a matter, and it's a valid difference of opinion, I will mention it to you. So I will not be imposing my own personal fiqh positions on anyone. Secondly, I do not rely on any weak narrations. Every single narration which I quote in these lectures, by the grace of Allah, I research, make sure this is a sahih hadith. Whether I give you the reference in the lecture or I don't is irrelevant. But it is authentic narrations, unless I took it from a scholar who said it's authentic, and it is not. But everything has been verified. So you can feel at ease that I'm not bringing something, you know, from my mind or something from the opinions of strange individuals. Everything is from the statements of the scholars, reliable scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So be ready. Now, women in Islam have been given rights which are not found in any other religion on earth. Believe it or not, in the year 586 AC, after Christ, or that's one of the ways they explain that abbreviation, the church had a number of meetings and they finally came out with a concession. This concession was only brought about after debates, discussions, arguments, and like a revolution. You know what was the result of this debate? What was the new information they discovered? What did they agree about? That the woman was actually a human being. Sisters, please, time out. That the woman is what? A human being. However, she has only been created to serve men. Women, finally, before they were debating, she's a devil. She's the one who told Adam to eat from the tree. She is, you know, one of the early Christian theologians, his name is Tertullian. He said, the women are the gate with which the devil enters. She is the purpose, she's the reason behind the fall of Adam. Another one, Saint Augustine of Hippo, he said, whether it is a wife or a mother, whether it is a wife or a mother, it is the evil temptress, Eve, that we should be aware of in women. I don't see any purpose. There's no benefit for a man to benefit from a woman if we exclude the concept of bearing children. Meaning, if women didn't give children for men, we don't know what men would need for women. What need would men have for women? No need for women. Up until the year 1856, in England, a woman did not have the right to inherit anything, Even if she had a job and she earned a salary, her salary would go to her husband or her father or her brother. She wouldn't have the right to keep any money, nor own any property. This is the reality. This is what women had to go through in historically, in recent times. I'm not speaking about a million years ago. These are in recent times. A woman was considered to be nothing but a devil. Finally, they said she's a human being created to serve men. As a servant, only. Now, Islam came, and Islam liberated the woman, and he freed them from this nonsense, from this extremism, or the sexism as they call it, where, you know, you prefer a particular gender over the other. And women were given rights which are not found in any other religion except in Islam. Even though the propaganda and the misconceptions about Islam seem to indicate otherwise, but we should be able to explain to the people the false conceptions that they present and the Islamic truth that we have. And tonight we will be getting a share of that bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. Now when we deal with the discussion about women, there's a character which actually both men and women need to have. If we don't have this character, trust me, everything I will say tonight will be of no benefit. Everything I'll say tonight will make absolutely no change in anyone, not a brother, nor a sister, unless we possess this character. This character is so fundamental in Islam that the Prophet ﷺ made it part of Islam and part of Iman, and he said, if you don't have it, then you will act like someone who's not a human being. Do as you will. What am I speaking about? Haya. Haya, which comes from the word hayat, really life. Hayat can be translated to English as modesty, bashfulness, shyness, honor, shame, these kinds of meanings. It is someone feeling insecure, uncomfortable when they are doing some ill conduct or people are looking at them. You feel ashamed, right? You feel shy. This is haya. Haya, according to the Prophet ﷺ, is the khuluq of Islam. He said, لِكُلِّ دِينٍ خُلُقًا وَخُلُقِ الْإِسْلَامِ الْحَيَاءِ. Every religion has an innate character, and the innate character of Islam is haya. Haya, modesty, bashfulness, shyness. He said, الْإِيمَانُ بِضْعٌ وَسُتُونَ شُعْبًا وَالْحَيَاءُ شُعْبَةٌ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. Iman is 60-some parts, is 60-some branches, if you want to say branches. And haya is a branch of Iman. From among the many things he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could have mentioned, he particularly chose, after saying that Iman is 60-some branches, haya being a branch of Iman. He said in another narration, إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِي فَفْعَلْ مَا شَيْتْ وَفِي رِوَيَ فَصْنَعْ مَا شَيْتْ. If you do not feel shy, then do as you will. That is not encouraging evil. But that means if people don't have haya, they will do anything. They will do anything. What prevents people from going into extremes? Their shyness, being ashamed. Of what? We will see. Of who? We will see. Because this is a broad idea or in Islam. Haya is not something that can be discussed within minutes, but we will deal with the good haya and the bad haya, because we have good haya and we have bad haya. All that will become clear inshaAllah ta'ala. Let's begin with the good haya. The good haya is at three categories. First, that one feels ashamed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This actually is ihsan, to worship Allah as if you can see Him, but if you can't reach this level, then know that He sees you. What does that mean? That means that any time a brother or a sister are in a situation where they are about to disobey Allah, their haya, their modesty, their shyness, their bashfulness from Allah will prevent them from embarking upon this sin. Why? Because their understanding and their realization that Allah is observing them, He will bring them to account and they will be questioned. So they will become shy to disobey Allah. This is very important. If we had this quality and it was functioning properly, if this was a quality that was functioning in our lives, then imagine how often we would disobey Allah. Not that often. We will not become angels, no doubt. But our disobedience to Allah will become minimum. Will become minimum. So, this is the first level. The second is being shy of people. The same way a child is ashamed to have his mother catch him doing something, or maybe a student is ashamed to have his teacher catch him doing something, or something of this nature. What will remind us of an example, an example which will remind us of this quality is that of Aisha radiallahu anha, who said that I used to, you know, the Prophet was buried in the Hujra, in the chamber of Aisha. Then who was buried after him? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Then who was supposed to be buried there? Aisha herself. However, Umar radiallahu anhu, before he passed away, had requested that he would be given that privilege to be buried alongside with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr. Aisha radiallahu anha, being the righteous, virtuous woman that she was, she gave up and her part. She was an altruist, as they say, and she allowed him to take what was rightfully hers. So, before Umar died, when she would enter into her house, she used to take off her clothes. Right? This is her house. Who's dead? Who's buried there? The Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr. After Umar was buried there, she would no longer go into the house and take off her clothes because she was shy of Umar. He's dead. She knows that he's dead. However, the shy, the level of modesty that the Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers, had, did not allow her. She felt uncomfortable that even a dead man who is buried, because he's present in the room, that she will undress in the room. She said, before I used to go when it was my father and my husband. Now, it is not the case anymore. Subhanallah. That's Aisha. Tell this to the woman today. Tell this to the woman today, which we will deal with later, and you will see that we are on, you know, two opposite extremes. These are the mothers of the believers, and the sisters are supposed to be the daughters of the mothers of the believers, the daughters of Islam, supposed to represent her and not oppose her and go against her. But Allah musta'an. And the last kind of modesty, good haya, is with oneself. And this is the highest level. When you become shy of yourself to act sinfully, you see, you reach a level where you become embarrassed if you disobeyed Allah. And you start talking to yourself. And you feel this odd feeling overtakes you, you know? You start having these mixed emotions because of a sin. This is a quality of the believers. The hypocrites on the other side, no matter how much they disobey Allah, as Ibn Mas'ud said, it's like a fly that comes on his nose and he goes like this to it. The sins for the hypocrite, no matter how many they commit, they are like a fly that comes on one's nose and it goes like this. Whereas the believer, a single sin is like a mountain that he's carrying on his back. So this level then is a level of Iman, which Allah knows whether we have or we don't. But we should strive. How do we do that? How do we attain that? By doing righteous deeds and gaining knowledge. Most importantly, knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were praying with us in the masjid, which I've always recommended to the brothers to pray in that masjid and not pray in this particular musalla because of the rulings on the musalla which we have dealt with, come early, pray in the masjid. The masjid that is here next to the graveyard, has the imam has wonderful recitation. And among the ayat he recited tonight was, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. The people do not give Allah the status which he deserves. They don't have the right understanding of who Allah is. And because of that, they live a life of negligence. The life of someone who is heedless from Allah. But if we truly knew Allah, لو قدر الله حق قدره, if we gave Allah what is rightfully His, of the greatness of Allah, the glory of Allah, the grace of Allah, then we will be behaving in a whole other way. If we had this understanding, but because people don't, they disbelieve in Allah. They say He has children. They say He has a wife. They say God has a mother. God has a son. And they turn Him into a triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And we get into a big mix-up. A big mix-up. Because we have not really understood the greatness of the Creator, the greatness of the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And this is something that we Muslims should be on the top of the list in terms of acquiring in our lives. That requires some effort, which we should spend. Bad haya. Is there such thing as bad haya? Oh yeah. Oh yeah. People being shy to obey Allah and His Messenger. Have you ever heard of this one before? Have you heard it before? Yeah. People are shy to obey Allah and His Messenger. So, you find, I mean, I'm not going to mention too many examples because this is not the topic. But people, when they have been commanded by Allah and His Messenger to do something, and that something winds up going against what is customarily accepted by the people, what is entertained by the people, they become ashamed to obey Allah and His Messenger, but they have no problem in obeying the people, so they will abandon Allah and His Messenger and please the people. A'udhu billah. You know, for instance, the issue of drinking water. The issue of drinking water while sitting down is a very sensitive issue in Islam. There's a difference of opinion among the ulama because of the many narrations which you have. But let's say, the least to say, is that the most sound and safe opinion is that you should never drink water standing unless you are in a situation where you cannot sit. Okay? Let's put it that way. If you're drinking Zamzam or you are in a position where standing is not feasible, drink standing. However, if you have the choice to sit down, then sit down. Many people are too shy to do this. Say, brother, sit down. Say, there's no chair. Say, brothers, how did people sit down before they invented chairs? You sit on the ground. Say, okay, I'm not going to ask you to sit on the ground. Because if the people saw you sitting on the ground drinking water, they're going to think something is wrong with you. But you can squat. You can squat for this 1 minute to drink your water according to the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in your mind, alhamdulillah, Allah sees me. Allah will be pleased with me. I will gain Allah's love because I'm imitating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I would not be worried about X, Y, and Z. Oh brother, you know, why are you doing this to brother? Who cares what people think? But the problems that sometimes we have is that we favor the people and we ignore Allah and His Messenger. And we can give many examples about the pants, and we will deal with that inshallah in a special lecture. Knowledge today, you know, someone, if he's, you know, involved in da'wah, if his job is a da'ya, and you tell him, you know, it's not enough today for the people to be a da'ya. You know, if you're not a doctor or you're an engineer or something, say, brother, what do you do? Say, well, you know, brother, what do you mean? You know, brother, you know, I give da'wah. Oh, miskeen. Miskeen, wallah. This is the most honorable position. Subhanallah. The Prophet ﷺ was not a doctor, with all due respect to the doctors here and elsewhere. He was not an engineer. He was not an architect. He was not anything of that nature. He was a da'iyah. And this is the best thing in the world. I'm not saying don't become educated and everybody goes to the Islamic University tomorrow. But if you did, alhamdulillah. But if you don't, that's fine. But don't belittle da'wah, or don't belittle knowledge, that you're a student of knowledge trying to learn the deen. Some people are shy. And unless they have some worldly degree, they will not be able to function in the community. This should not be the case. So this is another example of bad haya. And again, you know, and we can give many examples, eating with the hands and otherwise. You know, people are ashamed to eat with the hands and so on and so forth, even though this is from the teachings of Islam. So one should favor Allah and His Messenger and ignore thing. That's what it is. This is bad haya, being ashamed of the people, not of Allah and His Messenger. Taib. Sisters in Islam, this was first for all of us. Now we're going to focus on them. Okay? But you need to be involved because you have something to do in the process. You're either a husband or you're a son or you're a father or you're an uncle. You're something to some woman somewhere in the world. So you're still involved, don't go to sleep. If I catch you sleeping, then I'm not going to do anything about it, inshallah. Ala kulli hal, If the sisters have haya, if they have real modesty and shyness, then that should prevent them from the following violations. That should prevent the sister from committing the following dangerous violations, which are today so common that you will think that they are totally halal and that I am the most extreme person to ever give da'wah in the world. But I'm not. And these things that the sisters are doing today are not halal. Don't believe me, I don't want you to believe me, but I want you to believe Allah and His Messenger. When I quote them to you, you better believe what will be said. And then you will see that there's no exaggeration whatsoever. And you will see that the sisters today, except those whom Allah has particularly shown mercy to, are off the path to Jannah. And now we know why the Prophet ﷺ said that they are the majority of the people of Jahannam. Because not that many women are doing what Allah Azza wa Jal wants them to do. However, we assume that all the sisters have goodness in them. And that as us men, we fall into our shortcomings and we have our weaknesses. And that we will return to Allah. The same way we will leave alone bad deeds, sisters can do the same. But we must make that move. We must make that move. Number one, tabarruj. Anyone heard that word before? Tabarruj means the wanton display of beauty and adornment. Wanton, W-A-N-T-O-N, just in case you're thinking it's wanting or something. It's like immoral, lustful. Where a woman will present herself in a particular way, showing her charms and that which makes her look attractive to the other genders, sometimes to their own genders, wal-iyadu billah. But all this is not allowed. Now, let's deal with this issue from the perspective of the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which are known as ummahatul mu'minin, the mothers of the believers. Now, does anyone here doubt that they were the most righteous women in the world? Besides Mary, the mother of Jesus, we don't know of any woman who was so righteous like the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, be it Khadija, Aisha, or his daughter Fatima radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, or radiyallahu anhunna ajma'in. We don't know women who were more righteous than that. Now, with their righteousness, Allah told them in the Quran, فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ. Do not speak in a soft manner. Being gentle in speech, where the manner in which the woman speaks becomes desirable to the men. Now, we must first understand that the voice of the woman is not an awra, as many people think. Awra is in something that should be kept away, something that should be concealed. Women are allowed to speak. Women spoke to the Prophet ﷺ in the presence of men and the Sahaba. They had conversations. Even when the Khatib would be given Jum'ah, a woman would got up and corrected Umar radiallahu anhu arda concerning something. So women are allowed to speak, no one can deny that. We're not telling the sisters, become mute, You are to speak. However, the manner in which the sister speaks plays a major difference. Today, I realize that I have to wear glasses from now on. Right? I'm not wearing them right now because I'm not used to them yet. But while I was at the clinic where I got my eyes checked up, there was a very uninteresting event taking place simultaneously while I'm waiting for the doctor to arrive. A man was sitting there chatting with a woman. She was a nurse. Now, of course, as a man, I'm supposed to look away. So now, looking away is being established to the best of my ability, but listening is something that I can't help, because I'm sitting there. And you see, the conversation between these two is a very disturbing conversation. You see, how do you know in the way the sister, if she was a sister, I don't know what she was, whether she was a Muslim or not, the way she was speaking to this man was flirtatious. The way, the sound, the intonation, okay, the pitch of the voice, when it goes up and when it goes down, and all this is something important. Allah addressed the women, the wives of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فلا تخضعن بالقول فيطمع الذي في قلبه مرض. So the one in whose heart is a disease will be moved with desire. Meaning a woman may intend something good, but a man who has a sickness in his heart, when he hears this manner of speech, when he hears this manner of speech, he will be moved with desire. So then they were commanded to speak in a particular way. This is the most righteous woman. So what do we say about women who are less in status than them? This is more applicable to them, and they should be more cautious concerning this ruling. Then Allah went on to say, وَقُلْنَ قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا, and say and speak in an honorable manner. Say something which is good. So the way a woman speaks to her husband is unlike the way she speaks to the man in the shop whom she's buying some stuff from. They're not the same. No giggling, no joking, no laughing, you know, a laugh here and a smile there. No, no, no. This doesn't work. Because this will open the door for disasters. Needless to say, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Then Allah said, وَقَرْنَا فِي بُيُوتِكُنْ, and remain in your homes. It doesn't mean that you're not allowed to go out. However, it means that do not go out unless there is a necessity. Going out for no reason, for the women that is a source of fitna for herself and for the men around her and for the society. Unless she has to go, ma'a salama. Have fun, sister. Halal fun, that is. Go out, do your stuff, and go back home. But the way it is done today is what? It's like the whole country. Driver and some lady sitting in the back. Drop Prophet Aziz Mall, go to the mall for 2.5 hours, you know, going around, fitna, 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 then come back and go home. The next day, to some other, you know, Blue Sea Mall. I don't know what that mall is called. Every day they come up with a new mall. Next thing you know, they're gonna, you know, I don't know, man. You're gonna come into your house and find that they open a branch of the mall in your house. Say, oh man, what is this? Also, the malls, man, everywhere now, there's a branch in your own house. Every day, you know, everywhere you go, everywhere you go, if they were dressed good, yeah, akhi, ma fi mushkila. But the problem is, it's not the case. It is not the case. We will get there. So, قَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنْ, remain in your home, sister, unless you have some business to attend to. Either you have a job, you have to earn a living, alhamdulillah, you have to go out, you have to go buy your own personal stuff, go. But unnecessary hanging out is un-Islam. So the sisters need to be mindful of that. Then Allah said finally, or not finally, وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى, and do not display yourselves as the way it was in the early times of days of ignorance. In the early times of the days of ignorance. Do not display yourselves in this fashion. Listen to this commentary by the Sahaba and the Tabi'een. Okay, this is very important. Mujahid said concerning this, the tabarruj, or the woman, you know, doing tabarruj is women walking in front of men. He said, if women walked in front of men, then this is what is referred to in this ayah. This is a form of tabarruj which Allah had prohibited for the women. Needless to say why. According to Qatada, he said a woman walking in a shameless and flirtatious manner. The way she's walking is like swaggering. You know, she's, you know, I'm not going to describe that to you. The way the lady walks says a lot, right? And this is no news to any man here. It is known for the women and the men anyways. The way a woman walks, the way she moves her arm, the way she speaks, the way she turns her head, everything has signals. It sends out signals, just like the cell phone. It, you know, there's reception, you pick up, you know, mobile, 3 bars, 4 bars, same thing. You put out a few of these, you know, things and you start picking up reception, Bluetooth starts coming in, and the list goes on. Why? Because men know. The way a sister walks is half of the questions that they have been answered already by the kind of shoe, how high the heel, you know, almost walking, you know, she, every other step she's about to break her neck. Look, your sister, buy flat shoes at Raihina. nice and flat shoes and walk, and you don't have to worry about breaking your neck and breaking your heels and running down the street. What do you need some high heels for anyways? Trying to keep away from cockroaches and rats? It's not going to work. A mouse is going to scare you even if you're wearing high heels. And then you will not be able to run away from it. Keep them flat shoes, you know? Beautiful flat shoes. And we will deal with other things pertaining to the shoes anyways. We're coming there. Muqatil ibn Hayyan said, what is intended by the woman, you know, doing this kind of tabarruj, is where a woman will put on a khimar, head cover, however you can see her necklace, you can see her neck, and you can see her ears. And this is among the most amazing things I've ever seen in my life. You go to a mall, or you don't go to a mall, you go down the street, and you see a sister covering her head, and her chest is open. Come on now. You ask any man in the world, brother, what is more attractive to you? Hair or another body part? The answer is no. What is the objective of covering the hair if the chest, the skin, I'm not speaking about, you know, some skin, but you can't help it. You cannot help it because this is the society you're living in. Now, you know what's interesting? I received an email, subhanAllah, look at the timing that Allah decreed. Ironically, I received an email today from some brother. And the email was about this very topic. And it said that there was a woman who went out to the souk. Actually, there were two sisters sitting with each other. One of them suddenly started wearing the full hijab. And her friend told her, what happened to you? You know, you didn't used to wear this, you know, this complete hijab. So she told her, you know, I must tell you what happened to me. Alhamdulillah, that guided me to that which many women have not been guided to. She said, tell me what happened. He said, I went out, as I usually go out to the marketplace, going to the mall, you know, wearing my jilbab with all the adornment on it and my pants, so, you know, you can see my pants and high heels and blah, blah, blah. My face was, you know, with full of makeup. And I walked by and a man started staring at me. Okay? She said, okay, well, that's normal. That's what she wants at the end of the day. So the man is staring at her. Now she said, there's nothing that he can do because, you know, we're in a society where if he was to touch me, everybody's going to, you know, protect me. So what's the big deal? So anywhere she went, the man was there. And then finally the man approached her. And he said, haram alayki. It's haram what you are doing. She said, what am I doing to you? He said, you are torturing everyone around you. By you doing what you're doing, you are torturing everyone around you. Then he said, رَبَّنَا آتِهَا ضِعْفَيْنِ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ. He said, oh Allah, give her a double portion of the punishment. And then this kind of shocked her. Because she didn't realize that when she went out of the house in this particular fashion, every single man who looked at her, because even though he didn't want to, but he looked at her and he found something that interested him, something that made him feel a particular feeling, she will gain a sin. So imagine in an hour visit to the mall, and leaving back. And this is brothers who fear Allah. Brothers who fear Allah have to go struggle. This was a man who was appearing to be righteous, having to struggle with himself not to look at this woman. Then what do you leave for the men who have no problem staring and glaring from top to bottom? All this will be in the book of deeds of the sister. In one visit to the mall, she may be purchasing a ticket for Jahannam. That's what it is. And that's what we said, the Prophet ﷺ said what he said. Because they don't realize the reality of this action of theirs. They think it's La La Land, you know? Alice in Wonderland. You do whatever you want, life goes on, no accountability, no responsibility, whatever the men do, this is their problem. No. No, sister. You share the sin of making these men seduced. So then this email came and the sister repented to Allah. When she realized, what am I doing? Am I causing all this? They call it in collateral damage. You know, damage, devastating damage that cannot be counted. It's too much. But that is what is going on in the Muslim world today. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى طيب. So then this was their idea of that. That if the woman was she could see her necklace, her earrings, other body parts, then we have failed. And tabarruj in essence also means makeup. So anything which, whether it is lipstick or eyeliners, or I'm not very professional in the various names of these, you know, cosmetics or whatever they call them. Anything that the sister puts on as means of displaying herself falls under tabarruj. And Allah called it, this is the tabarruj of jahiliyyah. This is like the days of ignorance. Now, the whole time I'm speaking, I am not expecting any sister to cover her face or her hands, because of the fact that there's a difference of opinion among the scholars, and because of the fact that I personally follow the opinion that is not obligatory that a sister covers her face and her hands. Even though it's recommended, she gets rewarded for it. It's a sunnah which we love that all sisters will implement to reduce the fitna in the society. However, I cannot say that you must do it and you're sinful by not doing it. That if you're exposing your face, meaning you're doing all that, no. We're saying, don't put any makeup. If you're going to show your face and your hands, then there should be no nail polish, and we spoke about the stewardess and the airplane with her earring hanging from her nail, and we gave some practical examples for that. You know, nothing of this nature. Any kind of makeup is unacceptable, and the sister should strictly leave that alone. Secondly, if the sister has haya, then she should observe her hijab. And hijab, we will go into the details now of the hijab. First, we should know the following hadith from the Prophet ﷺ, where he said, صنفان من أهل النار لم أرهما. Then he went on to mention, نساء كاسيات عاريات مميلات رؤوسهن كأسمنة البخت المائلة لا يدخلن الجنة ولا يجدن ريحها وإن كان ريحها لا يوجد من مسافة كذا وكذا. There are two groups or two kinds of the people of the hellfire which I have not observed during my time. This is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking. I did not see them because they didn't exist yet. Among them were women who are dressed in, they are naked in spite of being dressed. يعني dressed yet naked. Okay? Ma'ilatun mumilat in some of the narrations. They are seductive, they are seducing themselves and they are seducing others. They are astray and they are leading others astray. Their heads are like the humps of camels because of the hairstyle which she has. He said, they shall not enter paradise, nor shall they even smell its fragrance, even though its fragrance can be smelled from such and such distance. Yeah, I mean, they will not come close to Jannah, let alone enter Jannah. Why? Women who are dressed yet naked. How would that be? That could be in many different ways. Either it is see-through, or it is tight, or I will explain to you one by one. How do you, he said another narration, إِلْعَنُوهُنَّ فَإِنَّهُنَّ مَلْعُنَاتٌ. He said, curse them because verily they are cursed. That's the reality. The conditions of the hijab, sister in Islam. A, it should cover your body. Allah says in the Quran, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنْ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنْ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنْ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنْ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنْ إِلَّا عَلَى بُعُولَتِهِنْ until the end of the ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, tell the believing women to lower their gaze, to lower some of their gaze. If they are looking at a man with a desire, with an attraction towards the man, this man, they're not allowed to continue looking. Otherwise, looking at a man in general is allowed. Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam picked up Aisha on his back and she was watching the Ethiopians, they were wrestling in the masjid. Right? And we have evidences that the women looked at men. But if that is associated with some other feelings, then it becomes a no-no. Whereas for the men, we don't have these two. You can't look at a woman, period. Zero. Nada. No Spanish, I know only a few words. Anyways, cannot look at them. And a woman cannot look. Then Allah says, وَلْيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ and let them protect their private parts from anything that will lead them into being misled and misleading others. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and let them not expose any of their adornment except that which appears necessarily thereof. The ulama have differed. Those who say that a woman must cover her face and her hands They say the only thing then that appears thereof is the outer garment. You can't hide that. As for those who say that the covering the face and the hands is not obligatory, then they say what is intended that appears thereof are the hands and the face. That's it. Anything else, Allah prohibited the women in the Quran to allow them to show. Then He said, and let them wrap their garment over their chests. Let them cover themselves with this garment so it will cover their whole body. So a sister should cover everything. If she follows the opinion that showing the hands and the face is allowed, this is the face, her ears are not part of her face, they should be covered, okay? Her hands should be covered up to here. What some sisters do today of wearing these big old, you know, remember I mentioned the example of the elephant, you know, going into the sleeve of some of this, you know, these new jilbabs right here. You know, the sister may, you know, clean the ground with it. In case the baladiya, everyone out of business, they just get a bunch of these sisters and they put their arms like this and they walk in the street, pick up the trash, you know, like this, and dump them on the side, mashallah, big long sleeves, right? You can have a baby, pull out a baby, you know, like magicians, you know, pull them out of hats. Now they pull them out of their sleeves. Anyway, so you see her arm, you know, you see her elbow. I'm sorry. You see her, you know, elbow, and it's, you know, what is this? This is not allowed. This is part of your aura, sister. This is part of your body that should be covered. If you want to show your hand, stick to the hand. Your arm is not part of it. Your elbow is not part of it, let alone anything else. So that's as far as the top, right? The chest is covered, the neck is covered, everything is covered. Only the face, only that round spot in the front and your hands. How about the feet? This is where we have disasters. Allah said in the same ayah later on, وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَ بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ. And let them not stamp their feet, so it will be known what they are hiding from their adornment. Very important ayah. Two evidences. Number one, that women must have been covering their feet. Because if they were not covering the feet, she would not have to stamp her feet for the people to see the khilkhal, called in Arabic. In English it's called an anklet. They will be able to see it case closed. But because the women were covering their feet, and some of them had a little issue, and they wanted to attract the men, the only way they were able to do so is by stamping their feet so that khilkhal will make sound, and the man will realize that the sister has something, some adornment, which is enough for a man to go far with his imagination, simply by hearing some chick-chick coming out from a sister's leg. That's the reality. And Allah prohibited that in the Quran. Do not stamp your feet so it will be known to men what you are hiding from a dormant. Now, this is the evidence number one. Evidence number two, the authentic narration from the Prophet ﷺ. He said, مَنْ جَرَّ ثَوْبَهُ خَيْلًا لَمْ يَنْظُرِ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ قَالَتْ أُمُّ سَلَمَةَ فَقَيْفَ يَصْنَعُ النِّسَاءُ بِذِيُونِهِنْ قَالَ يُرْخِينَ شِبْرًا قَالَتْ إِذَنْ تَنْكَشِفُ أَقْدَامُهُنْ قَالَ فَيُرْخِينَهُ ذِرَاعًا لَا يَزِدْنَ عَلَيْهِ. Listen to this narration. The Prophet ﷺ was speaking to the men, and some of the women were present, including his wife, Umm Salam. He said, whoever drags his lower garment below his ankles out of arrogance, Allah shall not look at him on the Day of Judgment. Okay? Umm Salam said, O Messenger of Allah, okay? O Messenger of Allah, how then do the women deal with their hems? That which, you know, the bottom part of their clothing. What do they do with it? He said, يُرْخِينَهُ شِبْرًا. They should lengthen it a hand span. Thereupon she said, إِذَنْ تَنْكَشِفُ أَقْدَامُهُنْ. She said, then their feet will be exposed. She knew that the feet should not be exposed. And if they were allowed to be exposed, he would have told her, that's fine. Because she said that as a illah, as a reason, he said, then they should release it a cubit, like an arm's length, and they should not go farther than that. Meaning below the ankle, an arm's length for the sister, dragging behind her. Why? So her feet would not be exposed. No one can refute this hadith, with all due respect to anyone here. No one. She told him, then their feet will be exposed. He said, then let them lengthen it a cubit. Meaning this is for that. To cover the feet, then lower or lengthen. within the garment. No, now today, this is uncommon. Even some of our sisters who Allah has guided to wear, alhamdulillah, they put hijab, they are failing drastically in this area. Where they're buying some, you know, fashion shoes, you know, that are an adornment in and of themselves, and they're wearing them and thinking that, you know, everything is fine. Don't be fooled by men. Men pay attention to everything. That's the way Allah created us. We're not going to sit here and play games with each other as men and women. These are facts that no man here can deny unless he's from the other kind. When he's from the other kind, there's no comment to say afterwards. But if he's a normal person, nothing will be missed. Nothing will be missed. So these shoes play a role. They play a role. These feet play a role. So these shoes that show half of the feet are not allowed. Ankles being shown by the sisters, not allowed. The complete cover, the hijab must cover her whole body, except the face and the hands if she follows that opinion. If she believes that she should cover the face and the hands, then she should do so as well. So from now on, sisters, no more feet. No more feet. Not for you. Now you can keep your feet at home. Not for the men in the street. Buy some shoes. Now, of course, it may be troublesome if you don't want to drag your garment behind you. Wear some socks, some black socks, plain, thick black socks, that is. Not something that is worse than, you know, not having socks. And then wear some shoes that cover these socks in such a way where there will be no skin appearing. And there's nothing attractive there either. Okay, these are things that we need to act upon. The second condition of the hijab is that it should not be a display. Yani the hijab itself, and this is again where the sisters are falling into some major errors. May Allah rectify our condition in theirs. Where the new muda, you know what muda means? Fashion, is that the hijab is not a hijab. It's one of these amazing things in the world. I had an example I thought of back in the masjid. I cannot seem to recall it right now. The objective of the hijab is what? To cover the sister. You know, Allah says to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya ayyuha nabi, kulli azwajika wa banatika wa nisa'i al-mu'minin yudnina alayhinna min jalabibihin thalika adna ayyu'arafna fala yu'dhain. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. O Prophet, tell your wives, your daughters, and the daughters of the believers to draw their veils over their chests, to cover their bodies. This is more likely that they will be recognized as honorable women, so they will not be harmed. What is the objective of the hijab? That the sister is not harmed by men who seem to have some strange tendencies. So when the hijab is inviting the man to look, then this is no longer a hijab, even if you had a million stamps on it that said hijab. It is not a hijab. Hijab is covering. Hijab is protecting. Veil. Hijab is a veil. It veils you from men. If it's calling the men to look at you, then we have defeated the purpose. I've given many examples before. I told you about the sister walking down the street with a jilbab that had a heart on her back. Love me. Is there another message that you can get? If I came to this lecture and I had a heart here. Say, what is this lecturer, man? No, we need to stop coming to this, brother. What do I want? What do I want with a heart on my thawb? Billah alayk. Say, something's wrong with me. Would you wear a jilbab that has a heart on the back, walking down the street? You know, like, okay, I'm sorry, you know, I'm not getting the message, or I'm getting the message, but I don't want the message. Otherwise, you know, the new jilbab now, did you see the new? Of course, some of these are like 2,000 riyals, 3,000 riyals, you know. You think you're buying a Mercedes, but it's only a garment. It has like a see-through layer, and under there's like a tablecloth. You know, like the flower, you know, the whole flowery thing. Right? I've seen these ones, you know, but I was really shocked when I saw this one at IKEA. It's like the table, you know, the one that, you know, my grandma used to have in her house. You know, this ugly white one with, you know, red flowers and pink flowers. This is, you don't even want to eat on it. But of course, it's your grandma, you have to be nice to her. But now this is a new fashion. They make this into a jilbab. Then they put a see-through layer on top of it. And it's like now the hijab is a tablecloth. You have a table walking around. Just in case you felt hungry, you could just place her and, you know. Is this a hijab? Is this a hijab? When a man has to look 5 times to make sure that my eyes are seeing, you know? Am I really seeing this? You know, is this real? Is this hijab? No, this is culture. This is pleasing the people, not pleasing Allah. This is because my dad will beat me up, or because I don't know what I'm afraid of. The society does not allow me to go out with my tight pants. I'm having to wear this. I'm forced to wear it, but I don't want it. That's the message. That is the message when the sister go out in this fashion. Now, I'm not trying to tell you wear black, because you may wear blue, and you may wear white, and you may wear any color that doesn't become in and of itself means of attraction, right? The issue of color is a broad issue depending on the country and depending on the environment. If you come to a hospital, nurses wear white. So this is the way it goes. And now, how it is, you know, the way she's dressed is where we have an issue. Is she wearing regular tight pants and, you know, she has or something else that shows her body? That's a whole other discussion. Otherwise, the color is not what we're dealing with here. But the hijab itself should not be displayed. Should not be inviting the people to look again. It should be boring. So preferably, she has, you know, the long skirt or whatever that thing is. And it should be going from the head as opposed to the shoulders. Then on top of that, there's a khimar, which goes just above, you know, on the thighs. Above the knees. So it can be double covering for that upper part. You know, this is the best hijab in the world. Where the sister is totally boring. Totally boring. Disgusting to the men. So, oh, I don't even want to look again. Please, take this lady out of here. That should be, if the sister is establishing this, she is Mia Mia, inshallah. With Allah, she is in a very honorable situation if the rest of her iman is sound. That's what it is. Men should have absolutely no attraction towards her. The hijab must not be, the hijab must not be transparent. There, you know, if you see through it, then, you know, I don't know what it is. It should be roomy. Roomy. Not tight. So, you know, needless to say, anything which defines the body is not acceptable. And this is the fashion today. The jilbab is made tight at the waist, so it can show the rest of the body parts. This is insane. This is an insane kind of hijab. It should be a robe. You know, if you ever lived in a cold country, I don't think this is applicable here, but if you ever lived in a country where they have a cold winter, you know the feeling of this big fat blanket which you use to cover yourself with, you know, in bed at night? This kind of cozy feeling, but it's this big blanket that if you went under, you'll get lost, right? And you guys play games with each other, one goes from here, the other one comes from the other side, or maybe that's just me. Anyways, in case you have some similar experiences, this should be the way the sister feels in the hijab. She's about to fly. You know, it's so wide that if there was some wind, she could just fly away. You know, with wings. Because of how roomy her jilbab is. Anything that is tight is not allowed. It should not be perfumed. No bakhur, no oud, no nothing of this nature. The Prophet ﷺ said, any woman who puts on some perfume and goes out so men can find her scent is a fornicator or an adulteress. If she goes out with the intention of seducing the men with her smell, then she has committed the form of zina. So you keep your clothes plain. At home, you know, do whatever you want. Outside, no. Particularly when you are mixing with other men. It should not resemble men. You know, today in the Western world, the image of the, what is it, the ideal woman is a woman, you know, wearing a woman's suit. Have you seen the woman's suit? It's like, not like the tie, and but something similar, with a skirt up to the knees usually, and she's wearing her, you know, she has her luggage or whatever, and she's, you know, walking down the street with her high heels. Like, this is a successful woman, you know, of the world, and so on and so forth. Yeah, this one the Prophet ﷺ cursed. This woman who resembles a man, she looks like a man, she dresses like a man, is not allowed. A man should not resemble a woman, and we dealt with that last time. And women should not resemble men. Each have their own independent qualities and characteristics. It should not resemble the garments of the kuffar, the disbelievers. The Prophet ﷺ, according to Abdullah ibn Umar, he saw him, the Prophet ﷺ saw Ibn Umar wearing a garment made out of saffron, which is like an orange kind of dyed garment. He told him, take it off. This is from the clothing of the disbelievers. These are the clothes that are worn by the disbelievers. Take them off. So we don't resemble the disbelievers. This is for the men and for the women. So the sister should not wear something that is worn by those who do not believe in Allah and His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It should not be for fame. The hijab, the jilbab should not be for fame in order to stand out. See, the first one to get the jilbab with this new funky style, you know. So the sister wants to stand out when she goes to a particular place, so she will look different than everybody else. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man labisa thawba shuhratin fi dunya albasahu Allahu thawba al-madalla yawm al-qiyama thumma alhaba fihi naran." Thawba madalla yawm al-qiyama thumma alhaba fihi naran. Whoever wears the garment of fame in this dunya, Allah shall make him wear the garment of disgrace on the day of judgment, then he will be blazed with fire. So we don't try to stand out. We look like everybody else to the best of our ability, you know, and the sister should not wear something that makes him stand out, where people look at her and say, oh, this is extremely special, rather than different than everybody else. Taib, this was concerning the hijab. Next in line is the eyebrows. And we had a discussion regarding the eyebrows for the advice of one of the brothers. And to be more particular, let us deal with the hadith first. لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْوَاشِمَاتِ وَالْمُتَوَشِّمَاتِ وَالْمُتَنَمِّصَاتِ وَالْمُتَفَلِّجَاتِ لِلْحُسْنِ الْمُغَيِّرَاتِ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ The Prophet ﷺ, actually Ibn Mas'ud narrated this hadith. Okay? He said, Allah curses the woman who gets a tattoo, and the one who asks for it, the one who gives it, the one who does it, and the one who asks for it. And the one who plucks her eyebrows, or gets it plucked, both meanings are involved. And the one who files their teeth for as means of beautification, those who are altering or changing the creation of Allah. Now when Ibn Mas'ud said this, a woman from Banu Sa'ad, her name is Ya'qub, said, it had reached me that you are saying that Allah has cursed this woman. He said, would I not curse, and this hadith is in Bukhari Muslim, he said, shall I not curse that which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam cursed, and it is in the book of Allah? She said, I read the book of Allah from cover to cover. Look at the woman back then. I read the book of Allah from cover to cover. I came across no ayah that said that Allah cursed a woman who plucked their eyebrows and wear tattoos and so on and so forth. He said, did you not read the statement of Allah, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا? Did you not read the statement of Allah? Whatever the messenger gives you, then take it. Whatever he prohibits you, then leave it alone. He said, this is the evidence that he told you to leave it alone. I heard the messenger of Allah curse these women, meaning Allah curse these women. She told him, well, your wife does it. Your wife does it. He said, go and see her. So she went to see if, you know, I don't know where she got that claim from. And she found that she did not have that done to her. So she came back to him and said that she was wrong. He said, if she had been in this case, she would not be with me. If my wife was plucking her eyebrows or doing anything of this nature, she would not be with me. It's Ibn Mas'ud. She would not be my wife right now. These are the Sahaba. But we can imitate the Sahaba. Actually, we have been obliged to imitate the Sahaba. Allah had made it feasible. It's not some extreme, attainable thing. It's attainable, brothers and sisters. We should imitate the Sahaba to the best of our abilities. Perfume, we dealt with that. No perfume should be worn unless the sister is in an environment where there are only other sisters, or she will not be going and mixing with men. When she's going to come across men and they will smell her, sisters, please, no perfume. Deodorant, get this, you know, some of them have a very mild scent, you know, that they're not very strong. Anything that you need to wear that will not, you know, give out a very strong odor, this is what is expected of you in order not to cause fitna among the Muslims. Free mixing, men and women should not mix freely. And what we are having here, as we have mentioned before, is not considered mixing freely. Mixing freely is a brother sitting here, next to him is a sister, then a brother, then a sister, or all of us, you know, just mixing with each other like everything is fine, as people do in birthday parties and when they go to weddings and so on and so forth. That kind of mixing, which we are speaking about, is not allowed. The Prophet ﷺ said, furthermore, to specify about a man and woman, لَا يَخْلُوَنَّ رَجُلٌ بِمْرَأَىٰ إِلَّا كَانَ ثَالِثُهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ No man shall be alone with a woman except that the third is the devil. So a man and a woman being in one place without a third person is strictly not allowed in Islam. Needless to say, it will lead to a lot of disasters and a lot of calamities, which will result in the destruction of this Islamic Ummah in totality. And this is something that we cannot afford. Now, Facebook. You know, I hate Facebook. Sorry, Facebook. You can survive without me. Who cares? But why do I hate Facebook? First, because I don't have time to update, you know, what's going on in my life every 3 minutes. Second, because it became a double-edged sword, you know? I had been on the position that I don't want Facebook for the longest time, right? Even though some of my family members had advised otherwise. You know, get back with the old friends, give them dawah, you know, your old friends who have been said, you know, this is right. So then we, you know, got a personal Facebook with the methodology of no women will be added. Okay, no woman will be added. I don't care who it is. I don't give it's my grandmother. If she's going to have a picture of herself, grandma, I'm not going to add you on my Facebook, right? And I maintain this by the grace of Allah until we got a special Facebook for One Way to Paradise. You know, the website? Yeah. And this is when the problems came. MashaAllah, fans. We started getting fans from, you know, all over the world. And what fans we got? Fans which are not cool. You know, a fan is cool, right? These fans were tripping, as they say. I go to the Facebook page, you know, to see what's going on, and it has, you know, the friends here, you know, the list of friends, see all, and I don't know all these options, and all kinds of women, well, you know, with the she's wearing full makeup, no hijab, no nothing, posing half naked, you know, standing like this. So what do you want from my channel? This is One Way to Paradise, ya Shaykha. One Way to Paradise, and you're bringing me this, I don't know, you know, like it's advertising for some other agencies, right? And so, you know, then I realized that, you know, this is a calamity. Now, every time somebody has to visit the Facebook, they have to see the pictures of these women. So I'm making an invitation here. I'm calling out to all the women who have subscribed to One Way to Paradise Facebook. Please remove your pictures. Remove them. Put a flower. Put a diamond. Put a jewel. Put a mosquito. I don't care. But don't put yourself. Inshallah, you're wearing full hijab. Other sisters who are better than them, she puts on the niqab, you know, the niqab, but you still see her eyes. You know, and her eyes have been made specially special for the picture, you know. We're back in the same position. Yeah, Ukhti, I don't want to look at you. What benefit do I have from seeing you? And what do you want from me seeing you anyways? Or the rest of the world? I mean, this is where haya is, you know, running low. When you have no problem that millions of people may see you all over the world, exposed, that means that there's something missing in our life. Haya is not really, not functioning properly. So then, Facebook. Have a Facebook account, use it for dawah purposes, but we don't need pictures. Even brothers. Brothers, you know, are, you know, sometimes the brothers think we're picking on the sisters, that means that you're fine. Brother, you're not Sylvester Stallone back in his, you know, Rocky days. Trying to pose and look all handsome, you know. This is the same fitna. It's the same fitna. It is not allowed. Yes, a man is not an awra, but if you're posing with the intention that people say, oh, mashallah, what a handsome young man, then you are giving trouble to the sisters. So, you know, we need to stop these images. If you don't have a Facebook account or these other accounts that they keep coming up with every day, keep it pictureless. No, but we don't need to see an image of you. What is important to me is your name and whether you're a Muslim or not, or whether you're interested in Islam, or whether you fear Allah or not. Everything else pertaining to your appearance, it's none of my business. Of course, the beard for the men, we want that. And the sisters wearing the hijab. But to show me this on Facebook and or show the rest of the world is not okay. So sisters in Islam, please, from tonight, if you have internet connection at home, unless it's down as it usually is, go home and remove the picture. Put a nice river, you know, flowing. Anything else, but nothing that has a soul. Not an animal. You know, don't put a monkey instead. You know, try to play with the people. So, you know, we know that you don't look like a monkey, but we don't want a monkey, and we don't want you, and we don't want a lion, you know, or anything of this nature. We want a plain image. And if you leave a black box, ma fi mushkila. Something totally plain, no one will complain, wallahi. And we'd be very happy for you. Same thing for the brothers, huh? Because some of you have seen your images already. I can see you here, and I remember your pictures and on Gmail and other places. So yeah, that's for the Facebook. So to end this lecture, because I've taken longer than usual, and I apologize for that. What is our responsibility, brothers? Everything I mentioned falls on our shoulders, believe it or not. The sisters are expected to have their own, you know, individuality, and they should do this for the sake of Allah. However, if there's some sort of resistance concerning that, then it is upon us men to make sure that everything I mentioned is implemented in our homes. Except your mother. You can't do anything about that. If your mother doesn't want to wear according to the way of Allah, at no point are you allowed to force your mother to do something, because that's your mother. You advise her in a nice way, you remind her, you tell her that you love her, you do whatever you want, but you cannot force it on your mom, because that's your mom. But your wife, you can. Your daughter, you can. And I don't mean that you come in the house with a 9mm gun and say, you know, if you go put on this hijab, I'm going to put a bullet in your head or something along these lines, because that's gangster stuff and we don't have any gangsters in Islam. That means that you speak to your wife in a nice way and you tell her, yeah, you're my wife. What else do you want? Alhamdulillah, Allah blessed us with each other and life is good. Keep it, you know, personal. Let's keep our relationship personal. Keep these strangers out of the business. I don't feel comfortable you being viewed by so many million men per day, whether it is on the internet or in the streets. So this is something that you do with your wife, inshallah, all women, bi-ithnillah, have goodness in them, and they will abide. If not, then maybe this relationship is no good. It's no good. If the sister is going to continue to resist and not act according to the deen of Allah. I will end this lecture with a hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, ثَلَاثَةٌ لَا يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ وَلَا يَنْظُرُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِمْ العاق والدين والامرأة المترجلة المتشبهة بالرجال والديوث. Three shall not enter Jannah and Allah will not look at them on the day of judgment. The one who disobeys his parents, the one who is undutiful to his parents, the woman who resembles, who is mannish in her appearance and in her behavior, and a dayuth. Does anyone know what a dayuth means? He's a man who has no jealousy over his woman, folks. A man who has no problem having his wife display herself in a manner which arouses other men. Where some men have this intention, by the way. He wants men to feel that his wife is pretty. So he says, Ya Allah, put on whatever you want. So the men will see, oh, you know, this guy is lucky. You know, he got a Hummer and his wife is, you know, beautiful. But this is the youth. He shall not enter Jannah, according to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He does not have no jealousy over his woman folk. What is a real man? A real man does not play games with this stuff. When it comes to the woman folks and us protecting them according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wanting goodness for them so they can go to Jannah, we have no compromise in this area in our deen. So a man is jealous, if he sees any man looking in a particular way at his wife or his daughter, say, you know, you give him a look, say, what's your problem? What's your problem, akhi? You know, please, look in front of you. Keep off my family. If she's dressed correctly. If she's not dressed correctly, you know what? It's difficult for you to say anything. Because he may tell you, well, you know, cover her up first. And then come talk to me. And you will not be able to say a word. So let's not put ourselves in that position. Huh? Let's handle business ahead of time. So to conclude, brothers and sisters in Islam, we want to go to Jannah, ultimately, otherwise you wouldn't be here tonight. You would be sleeping in your bed watching some Islamic show or something else at home. I'm sure you're not watching any TV. You would not be here unless you wanted Jannah, bi-idhnillah. If you want to go to paradise, we have to make some effort. Men have some requirements and women have some requirements. For the woman, this is it. This is it, along with obeying her husband, and fasting Ramadan and praying her five daily prayers, Allah, the Prophet ﷺ guaranteed her that she will enter Jannah from any of the doors. That's it. Cover yourself. Live this life like the Aisha, like Khadija, like Fatima, like Umm Salama. Live like them for these 30, 40, 50, 60 years of your life and then go on to the paradise where you will never have to worry about hijab again. Do your job. Don't let the shaitan fool you. Don't become a fitna for yourself and for others. Don't follow your desires. And don't destroy yourselves and the Muslim ummah in the process. This is what I would like to convey to the sisters in Islam. And to any woman who wants to become a Muslim, who wants to go to paradise, this is the same thing applicable. Think of Mary, the mother of Jesus. And you will find a righteous Muslim woman. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us all to the straight path and to make us act accordingly. Wa akhiru da'wan alhamdulillah rabbil alameen wa sallallahu sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Is it permissible to shave the hair on the cheeks and neck, the beard? If it's for the sister, yes. معلش معلش some may have that. It's not funny. If it's a hello sisters, hello, we're still in the lecture. معلش معلش صبر صبر. You hear this all the time, huh? صبر صديق صبر. If it's a sister, yes, you may shave the beard, you may shave the hair on your cheeks and your neck. Seriously, and you are there's no sin on you. You may even get a laser operation to permanently remove this hair because this is something that is expected of a woman, and there's no doubt about that. Alhamdulillah. If it's a brother, no. And please go back to the lecture. Let it grow with a natural flow on onewaytoparadise.net, where I gave a whole hour lecture about the beard, hoping that no one will shave it ever again. But I see that, you know, anyways. When praying Fajr, Maghrib and Isha at home, should one read silently or loud? For Fajr and Maghrib and Isha, one should read loud, according to the Sunnah. However, if you recite silently, it's acceptable. If this is from the sisters, and I'm assuming it is from the sisters, then if there are other men around you, then you do not recite out loud. But if there are no men, I mean, of course, non-mahram men, that is. If it's a mahram, no problem. But if there are other men, then you do not recite out loud. Otherwise, you may, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum salam. Who are the people in front of whom a woman is not supposed to, not obligatory to cover her head? Uncle, grandfather, nephew, cousin, mahram, cover her head. Let me tell you something. Let me give it to you from the source, so I will not get philosophical here. Yes, and not expose their adornment except to their husbands, their fathers, their husbands' fathers, okay, which is like a father-in-law, I believe, their sons, their husbands' sons, their brothers' sons, their sisters' sons, their women, that which their right hand possessed, or those male attendants having no physical desire, or children who are not yet aware of the private aspects of women. These are the ones that you're supposed to cover yourself in front of. This was here, this is here. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum assalam. What do you mean by filing of teeth? And is it only prohibited for women or for both genders? And is it sin for a person to file teeth of other people, maybe non-Muslims? Oof. Well, my understanding, when we speak of braces, it's a whole other discussion. We're not speaking of braces. Filing the teeth, as far as I know, is an act that the woman used to do by placing something between their front teeth in order to cause a gap between them. Because they used to consider this to be part of beauty, even though today it's the other way around, right? But back then, this was considered a sign of beauty. So filing the teeth, this is all I know about that. Doing it for others, I mean, whether you are doing it or getting it done, it's the same. Because you're involved in haram. You know, at any time, for example, if somebody's drinking alcohol, it's haram. Can you serve him the alcohol? No, because it's the same thing. So you may not do it even if it's for non-Muslims. Wallahu a'lam, tab'an. If a national dress is worn by Muslims and non-Muslims of that country, is it accepted for us to wear it? Muslims, is it Islamically approved, of course? Allahu a'lam. If it's a national dress, worn by Muslims and non-Muslims. Okay, I think I know what you're aiming at. If someone looks at you and is unable to identify whether you are a Muslim or otherwise, then no. But the fact that you mentioned it's Islamically approved, meaning it's not going to be like theirs, because they're not going to observe the hijab of the Muslim woman. So inshallah, it's fine as long as you stand out as a Muslimah. People are able to tell that you're a believer from a long distance. Okay. The napkin? Oh, I'm sorry. That was mine. I have a question on niqab. I want to take up niqab, but my husband doesn't like it. What is the Islamic ruling on this case? The Islamic ruling is that you should obey your husband. If you believe that it is only a sunnah, if you believe that wearing the niqab is an obligation, then you have to do it. This is important. Now you cannot trick Allah. Allah knows what you believe. And you need to read up on this so you will know really what you believe. Because you may be confused. You don't know whether you should or you shouldn't. So you should read material concerning this. If you believe that wearing a niqab is obligatory, even if your husband doesn't like it, you must wear it. If you believe it's only a sunnah, and he tells you he doesn't want you to wear it, then you obey your husband and you do not wear it. This is for the sister. For the husband, why? Why would you not like your wife to wear a niqab? It's amazing to me. Unbelievable. What do you have to lose? More protection for your wife? More modesty for your wife? More, you know, barakallahu feek. Come on now. This is something you should be happy about. It should be the other way around. Usually it's the man telling her and she doesn't want, and there's this kind of resistance, not this one. So I advise the brother, leave her, let her obey Allah. You will win. It's a win-win situation for you. You're letting her obey Allah, you will get rewarded, an equal reward for all the good deeds she has because of covering her face. And second, you're protecting yourself in the future from any possible danger. You never know. You may be tested. So I advise the brother strictly, sincerely to let his wife wear the niqab. Inshallah, there's nothing to lose and everything to gain. Now, is it allowed to wear clothes that are beautiful in ladies' gatherings and having no intention to make others jealous or riyah, and just because one likes to wear beautiful clothes and look good only? No problem. No problem in looking good. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. So there's no one in Islam, nowhere in Islam it says, look lousy, look scary, look, silly. You look nice, however, within the limitations. If you just trying to look good, show what Allah has blessed you with in terms of clothing and so forth, without trying to look special, without trying to cause, attention or be showing off, then inshallah there's absolutely nothing wrong if the gathering is that of women only. Brother, please advise about bleaching our eyebrows. I was listening to a lecture by one of the shuyukh, and he actually had this question posed to him. And then I realized what the sheikh, what the lady meant. What they meant is, in order to avoid plucking their eyebrows, they will put a bleach in that area where there's black hair. So it will become blonde and no one will be able to see it. And it's a form of hiding it. The sheikh said, there's nothing wrong with that. Because it doesn't fall under plucking. He said, there's nothing wrong with that. If the sister is bleaching that area, changing the color of the hair. He said, the asl is that it's allowed unless we have an evidence that says it's not allowed. And we don't have an evidence. Until I have further opinions, I quote to you the opinion of a trustworthy alim. That it is fine if this is what you mean by bleaching, right around. But if you mean the half-half, then I go back to the earlier answer from the previous lectures, then you may not do so. Otherwise, it's fine, inshallah. But if you wear the national dress among ladies, Muslims and non-Muslims, okay? Women without hijab, okay, I guess the non-Muslims are women without hijab, and this way you won't stand out among the ladies only as a Muslim. Oh! Then no. Because when he saw Ibn Umar wearing the clothing which was worn by the kuffar, he told him, take it off, this is from the clothing of the kuffar. Meaning, stand out in your dress code. And the issue, the clothing themselves, they were not like below the ankles or they had other violations. It was the kind of clothing was that worn by the disbelievers. So in this case, again, if this is particular to their deen, meaning if it's a Hindu lady, and the Hindus are known for wearing this as part of their religion, then no. But if it's something that is common, just like a skirt, then of course everybody in the world may wear a skirt, and you cannot stop wearing a skirt, so you will not look like other non-Muslim women. So this is in areas where the dress code is particular to the woman's religion. If it's something that is national, strictly national, and it is not part of their religion, then inshallah there should be nothing wrong. But if you're able to, keep it in Islamic all the way, then this is far better, inshallah. Is wearing makeup even not allowed at home for husband or ladies gathering? Come on now. Life will be boring then. No, wear all the makeup in the world. Put on 10 lipsticks and just put your face in one of these things and just come out, and do whatever you want. If the husband likes it, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. He may have a funky, style. Whatever makes the husband happy, do it. As long as it's not haram. So there's nothing wrong with wearing makeup with your husband, obviously. And even in ladies' gatherings, as long as it doesn't become something excessive and it means of showing off, otherwise it's fine. Women among women, this is among the things they may show to each other, their arms and so on and so forth. So yeah, inshallah, you may do so. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Thank you.